There were things I couldn't teach my son. Things he'd have to learn from others, like living in a world with other people, respecting their rights, and assuming the responsibility of regular duties. But what I wanted most was that he grow up to be a good citizen.
It's so important for our students to feel their role as the office of a citizen.
Isidore's approach to learning was very radical compared to what was taking place in schools during that time.
Having just one side of an issue was the total way that civics was taught in his era.
It was very much related to rote learning.
But it was information that went in one ear and went out the other.
Very standardized, very mechanistic. He really wanted students to engage with the issues and come to have their own personal understanding of the issues.
Isidore wanted students to realize that there was another and maybe more than one perspective.
How do we get them to feel it, to understand it? And it's a never-ending process.
Isidore was born in Brooklyn, New York, of Russian immigrants. Isidore himself, in deciding what career to pursue, it was of course during the Depression, got a job teaching.
My first job was at Brooklyn Technical High School teaching history and civics. And by the way, I was going to law school at the same time in the evening, because at that time there were no jobs available for young men and women. Very few jobs, I should say. So we had to prepare for the future. The civics curriculum at that time consisted of the structure and function of city government, state government, and national government.
The curriculum in schools back in the 30s and 40s and even 50s was all very rote and a lot of lectures. And the idea was the teacher was the source of information, the students just memorized and regurgitated what the teacher or the textbook said, and that was considered learning.
My chairman told me that I must adhere to the present mode of teaching. It was as stark as that. No opportunity for creating anything. You simply had to use the textbook and question students from the textbook. And it was deadly, I must tell you. Now, the day I had to teach the different divisions in the police department, how do you differentiate the divisions? The night before I had to teach that at law school, we had discussed the Tombs, which was a prison in Manhattan. And what was going on in the Tombs was simply frightful. The suspects were subjected to torture to elicit confessions. The method was to lash a confession out of a convict.
They had talked about the third degree, which was a technique used by the police in New York City to get confessions from people who'd been charged with crimes. So he raised the issue to students, should the police engage in this type of technique?
And so I decided to start my lesson not with how many divisions are there in the police department, which do you think is the most important division of the police department? I turned my attention to what was in the newspapers. I told them we created a police department to protect us from crime. And when the police go beyond a certain point, we criticize them. So I said to the class, do you think that people ought to be lashed to elicit a confession? Is that what you have a police department for? And the result was simply astounding. Whereas the lessons had been deadly, they now had a life of their own. Everyone had an opinion on this.
And suddenly a class that was totally bored and not engaged got very lively. Everyone had an opinion, and he knew he was on to something.
Professor Hocking of Harvard made the statement that teaching social studies without the law is like teaching vertebrate anatomy without the backbone. The law is here, there, and everywhere. It's almost impossible to think of any activity that doesn't involve the law. And so it occurred to me that young people should be educated in the law as soon as they can read and write.
The idea is that young people growing up in school need to have a sense of the importance of law in society, the role that it plays in our democracy, an understanding of human rights.
For example, children in the elementary school ought to know something about the law in this sense. Why do we have rules? What do you do with a rule if you don't like it? What avenues do you have? And gradually develop activities so that they grow up with the law itself.
Law studies are not about memorizing what laws are or how government works or how to develop a contract. It's about empowering the individual to make really good choices for themselves and for the community and society in which they live.
I asked myself, what are the most important things in teaching government?
He looked at law in a conceptual way. He wasn't interested in teaching young people to be mini lawyers.
And my conclusion was that when students graduate from high school, they ought to have a vision of what we mean by liberty, justice, equality, property, and power. To me, those five were the essence of government. Every dispute that we have fits into one of those categories. In other words, if you have a dispute about your religion, liberty. If you have a dispute about whether the case was settled right or wrong, justice. Equality, you feel discriminated against. And property, there's private property, there's public property. There is property that has to be respected. There's property which is being used and abused. All of these take place under the five categories I've mentioned. Liberty, justice, equality, and property revolving around power.
Isidore was a big proponent of involving young people in mock trials and in moot appeals.
You don't need anything elaborate to have a mock trial in your classroom or a moot court in your classroom without anybody participating out from the outside. You can create it yourself.
Once people become engaged in the process of discovery, playing roles, working out the issues, they start to ask questions about the law and the system and how it works.
When President Truman was about to retire, he was asked, "Mr. Truman, now that you are retiring from the highest office in the land, what do you plan to do?" And Truman's reply was, "When I retire from the presidency, I'm not retiring from the highest office in the land. I'm assuming the highest office in the land, the office of citizen." After all, people elect presidents and congresses. So the idea of them holding the highest office in the land told me that civics ought to focus on the highest office in the land.
If we empower young people with fundamental principles of fairness, justice, human rights, they will help shape the world around us.
As it got toward the 50s, Joseph McCarthy was in the Senate. McCarthy got very powerful with his rooting out of communists in government. That had an effect all across the country.
A man named Joseph McCarthy appeared on the scene. This was in 1951. And when Joseph McCarthy appeared on the scene, he promised that he would drive every communist out of government. Every communist would be destroyed. And he started a movement in this country. The House Un-American Activities Committee was formed based on McCarthy's claim that there were communists everywhere, under the bed, in streets. In other words, he could find communists anywhere he looked. And there was absolute fear, a fear that I find difficult to describe. The best way to describe it, I feel, is to say that a pall of orthodoxy descended on the educational establishment. People were simply afraid to teach controversy.
from the Atlantic to the Pacific, covered with a network of professors and teachers who are getting their orders from Moscow.
Isidore has told me several times about the atmosphere of fear that pervaded the whole school system where he worked. Teachers were suspicious of each other. Administrators were being deluged with complaints. No one was willing to break out of that. Everyone towed the line. Isidore got called into the principal's office at Brooklyn Tech High School because of an activity, an interactive activity he did in the classroom. And he was told by the principal that another teacher had complained that he was teaching subversive activities.
I found that appalling. And what could I do? I didn't know what to do. So I thought I would write an article for social education condemning this kind of approach. I didn't mention McCarthy, but everyone knew whom I was referring to.
His first strategy for coping with this orthodoxy that was imposed on the schools was to write a series of articles for the National Council for the Social Studies.
And so I wrote this article, which I entitled Teaching Controversial Issues Through Supreme Court Decisions.
The publisher was very interested in publishing the material, but said there's only one problem.
He said, the title, Teaching Controversial Issues, is raising a red flag for the McCarthyites.
The reason that the publishers were concerned about this title being too controversial is they were also under the same form of fear about McCarthyism.
So we labored back and forth, and we agreed to call the article Recent Supreme Court Decisions. But anyone reading it could infer what it was all about and at whom it was aimed. And they understood what I was saying, that there was need for controversy, that the American Revolution had two sides, not one side, that the Mexican War had a Mexican side, not an only an American side. I felt that if the Supreme Court could confront controversial issues, teachers could confront controversial issues, students confront controversial issues, and controversial issues were the very essence of teaching.
So he subversively continued to write articles and publish them in Social Education under safe titles so that the teaching public would have access to these materials and be able to teach in a more radical way. And I really admire him for that.
That proved so popular that for 13 years I wrote a series of articles, Recent Supreme Court Decisions.
The response to his articles was overwhelming. Other people who felt the same oppression from McCarthy took up the mantle of Isidore and began teaching and using Supreme Court decisions in their own classrooms, being able to teach about controversy, but not labeling it as controversy.
There was widespread interest. A national conference was held in which the leaders of education, the law, political science, they all met to examine the value of this kind of approach. They all agreed that we have to change the teaching of civics in such a way as to bring it to life, to make it real to students. People liked it so much, and I gained a kind of a reputation that eventually I was elected president of the National Council based on these articles. That's when we began to think in terms of a national movement.
Law-related education became, starting in about the 60s, spread throughout the United States, and after that, throughout the world. Teachers who may not have ever heard of Isidore Starr, they may not have heard of law-related education, but they're doing a mock trial, they're doing a case study, they're taking pending Supreme Court decisions and having students analyze them.
Isidore Starr is an unsung hero. I think his work and his writing needs to be republished and reprinted, so that we all have access to his wisdom and his insights and ideas, because they're still relevant today.
We can't stop teaching these things in the hopes that they will settle into these individuals and become part of their makeup. So when they go to the polls, they will vote for people who are intelligent, who are honest, who don't know all the answers, who will do a lot of deliberation before they decide what to do. But we have to continue to try.